2 weeks ago, we listened to The Tortured Poets Department by Taylor Swift.
And after having 2 weeks with this album, we're going to give our thoughts on every single song and...
Stick around to the end and you'll get to hear our top three favorite songs.
We also wanted to let you all know that we are doing a giveaway. If you want to enter, leave your favorite lyrics in the comments. And what we're going to do is make you a super awesome custom shirt with those lyrics. We'll ship it to you on us. All you got to do, like I said, is leave a comment down below, like this video, and subscribe to our channel. We will announce a winner in 2 weeks from today. Good luck.
Let's get into it. I like the starting bass line. I know in our reaction, I said it sounded like a John Hughes movie, but I really thought about that. I was like, that's not right. It really sounds like it should be on Drive. Like,
yeah,
that bass line
it's like
is
a
total
bass, it's like wave. A, yeah, it's like a bass synth. It almost, like, instead of John Hughes, I'd say John Carpenter.
Okay,
yeah,
that's better.
Got like a synth poppy vibe, I'd say. And that driving bass synth is super cool. I love Fortnite, honestly, because I love Post Malone. He knows no bounds when it comes to genres, really. He's able to collaborate with anyone. And I just love the way their voices blend together on the song. It's a great opener.
I just love seeing collaborations on albums because it stretches the artist out of their comfort zone a little bit and introduces them to a new style.
This really does feel like it's the prior relationship, basically like that a time has passed and she visualizes this whole thing where, you know, I was in love with you back then, or we had some type of relationship and now we're acting like neighbors. She mentioned, you know, wanting to kill her husband for cheating and wanting to kill his wife.
Mm-hmm.
Basically like, we have to exist together. I have these feelings for you. And I like that aspect of it. So yeah, the Fortnite thing was really about their like 2 weeks back in 2014.
Interesting. More like a fling that was really intense, but then ended quickly.
I think that's a great way to set up this album because much of this album all starts at that point.
Love some of the stuff in the beginning when she talks about functioning alcoholic and aesthetic. And like, I've ruminated on that line a whole lot to think like, you know, is it literal?
True. I've gone back and forth with that. I thought maybe she was drunk on love. But then the following lines make me think, no, she's drinking because she had this and now doesn't have it and kind of wants it back, because she says, I hope you're okay, but you're the reason. I think she's saying, you're the reason that I'm a functioning alcoholic.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting what you said about like the love drunk, though, because, right, you know, the honeymoon phase of a relationship, those first few weeks are...
Totally.
You're kind of drunk on that person, so... I don't know, Taylor and her lyrics, man.
Because she's so metaphorical, you never know when she's being literal or not.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that whole bit, moved to Florida, I like that kind of foreshadow to Florida, mm-hmm, later, yeah, on. Love, yeah, the ending with post vocals. Yeah. And I hear that and I'm like, oh, I just want to hear it again. I got to hear more of them harmonizing together.
Another Fortnite Lost in America line I love, just, yeah, hearing him belt that.
I really liked this because of the setup, you know. I mean, the name of the album is Tortured Poets. She considers herself a poet. She's also saying this other person that she's with is a poet. We're modern idiots. Like, I really like that modern idiot line, because to me, that's saying, like, we're not really poets like this. Like, and that makes me think the whole album title is kind of tongue-in-cheek a little bit. It's not supposed to be taken so seriously.
I almost think of that line as, like, how most people view, you know, like a larger than life celebrity or whatever, and it's like, we're not geniuses, we're not, yeah, you know, right, what the humans. Headlines say, we're just scribbling words on a page.
That's a good point too.
I really like the flow of this song.
I like that she shouts out Charlie Puth too, because shout out to Charlie Puth, dude is an amazing musician.
As far as the sound, it still does carry over that kind of 80s synth pop,
yep,
from the previous song. My thought with that, though, is that it's kind of a transition from Midnight. So if you're listening to Midnight and go into this, it kind of carries that sound over and then slowly warps you into this kind of country-ish, wow, leaning.
Warps.
That's,
I like,
interesting.
That word.
Yeah.
That's an interesting thought, because these are synth pop heavy, the first few tracks, and so is Midnight's.
Mm. Yeah. This is an interesting song because it's not really a love song per se. There's like toxicity in it.
You speak about carrying over, but it reminds me of sort of carrying over from Fortnite. Like, what if this is the end of that, you know, you go from the good sort of to the bad, like, oh man, like this person is toxic and crazy and you know, like I don't know.
I've really tried to timeline it together, but in the middle I lose a little bit of it, like as far as like a conceptual story. This one, I believe in our reaction, like we really like the production of this.
Yep.
And I really like the fullness of it once it gets into the hook. Like, it's really loud and full and just sounds.
Those drums, man.
Drums are amazing.
They're just so crazy and like glitchy. It almost sounds like a loop that you, like, you know, like a pre-made one, just because it's so kind of crazy. Yep. But this song and the last song, I gotta say, Taylor's hooks or choruses just get stuck in my head, man.
Like, this one really did for me too.
Oh my gosh.
Same. I can hear it right now, especially with the O's.
Oh, so addicting.
Yeah, love that.
Said she wrote this from the perspective of the toy.
Once again, connecting to Fortnite, the shiny new thing that you get that's cool for a little bit and then you just toss to the side or whatever. I'm down bad, crying at the
gym. Catchy.
Banger, man. This is my first favorite off of it after the first listen.
Super catchy.
That like vocal sample and right in the beginning in the left ear just took me in. Classic Jack. That kind of carries on throughout. And to me, that really like represents almost like the alien, because it sounds like alien, robotish type. So I think that's what they're going for there. And then also all the UFO sense and all that throughout the whole thing. Alien being the person that brought her up, in this case, you know, whatever love interest. And I liked how she related the down bad to that. She's not up on the ship, she's not up feeling high, she's down off the ship, back to reality, however you want to take that. Yeah. I just really like that.
I took it as just like such an anthemic breakup song, like when you're finally past all the BS or almost past it, you know, you still might break down at the gym, but you're like living for yourself again, trying to take care of yourself, just getting better. And that chorus, man, when it just picks up and the whole song comes together, it's just like, I just want to hit the cardio.
Yeah, I liked all the space sounds and the UFO sounds. It really took the song to another level.
Love it.
A lot of F words though. This is definitely her most F word use.
Yeah, playing this in the car and Taylor's in the back. I'm like, well, I better skip this one.
It's crazy when I have my AirPods in and I'm singing it out loud at Walmart. Weird. So
long, love. Very much a ending love story breakup song. Like, I liked the tone of this because it wasn't so like scathing. Like, it was really just, I feel like, an honest song about people not working out, you know,
about a chapter closing,
right? Yeah. And still wanting good for the other person, you know. She says, I hope you find somebody too. So I love that whole aspect of it, and it's just a pretty song that Aaron Dessner produced.
I've said it a bunch of times, but I love sad songs, and this one, just the piano, having been in relationships before, and like I can just see the different chapters, you know. It's like you, when you get to a certain point with somebody and your heart's healed enough where you're like, this was bad, this was a bad situation, we didn't work out, I wish you the best type of thing.
Had a good run, a moment of warm sun, but I'm not the one. Lyrics hit deep.
I also just like the whole vibe of London, because there's times where it's like, you know, rainy and dreary there and stuff. I don't know, just this.
I like that connection you made.
She's still down bad, but she's climbing back up.
I really like this song.
Same.
Because it kind of reminds me of the Taylor that I fell in love with back when she first started writing music. It had that sound to it, that storytelling sound, I guess, that I really resonate with.
Yeah, it's really interesting because, yeah, we start to kind of veer into country. There's a little bit more leaning country instruments with the guitar, but then there's also like synth and stuff hidden in the mix. So it's very much like a merge of genres that I really like. And the way she sings it is very country, like you're saying, it sounds like her earlier stuff.
It does.
To your point with the production, it's a good transition for, you know, like you said, to the more country sounding stuff. Like, Jack blended that well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love the content of this song. I like what she wrote about the fan. She's saying...
That's how I take it.
How? Show me some lyrics.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Her screaming, but daddy, I love him.
So, yeah, to me, daddy is just a representation for all the people that don't approve of her relationship. Oh. And she kind of used it as a metaphor, which I think is genius. I mean, it's a common story. You know, you want dad's approval for the new guy. The bridge is where you really get into it. I don't cater to all the vipers dressed in impasse clothing. So all the people that are acting empathetic, like, you don't need to be with that person because blah, 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 blah. They're acting like they care.
They're just snakes. Yeah.
Right. And then you get God save the most judgmental creeps who say they want what's best for me, sanctimoniously performing soliloquies I'll never see. I love that. She's basically saying all these people online and stuff are saying these things about my relationship
that as I'll if never
I'm going to see it.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I love that.
Shout out to the subreddits and Twitter.
And as if they really know what's best for her.
Right.
I mean.
So in this case, I mean, if you take the muse as Matt Healy, I mean, they think they know him better than her, who has known him for 10 years.
Yeah.
Like, that's the part I take issue with. Like, she personally knows him.
Right.
It's her choice.
And then society just destroys it.
Right.
Yeah. Like. Who are we to say?
And I like it actually eventually changes where her parents approve, you know, went to my parents and they came around. They came around to liking him. All the wine moms are still holding out. All the people online and stuff are still not giving their approval. And then she says, but F them.
And this could just be any type of love interest. It doesn't have to be a specific person. It could be any person because everybody has thrown in their two cents about each and every person she's dated.
Yeah, agreed.
And I'm sure she's just over it at this point.
Totally. And that's why this is the most genius song. Yeah. The whole daddy connection, sounding like country.
You blew my mind, bro. With like, I mean, I have like a whole, I mean, that's makes this song 10 times more awesome for me. Fresh out the
slammer, I know. Yeah, this one, I liked it. I like the vibe of it. One common theme, which we just kind of touched on, of being caged, I feel like asylum, jailed, I feel like all that is a theme on this album as a whole. So yeah, in this case, she's saying the slammer was the previous relationship she was in, now she's out, and she's going to call the person she's been thinking about. Like, I didn't piece that together until I heard Guilty as Sin later on. I'm like, oh. She's been thinking about this while in her previous relationship and has really been building this up in her head.
I feel like that sets you up for failure, though, that you're building something up that long.
Yeah. Totally.
It's never going to be what you imagine.
Your expectations
are
never going to be met. Yeah.
Good, good song. I love the collaboration.
I love the background vocals that Florence does in this. Really cool sections of that. And like we said in the first song, it kind of foreshadows the song of I want to move to Florida. And this is kind of about the same thing, trying to get away.
I'd say it's more serious now with the 3 exclamation points.
They've
kind of upped their commitment.
I like the drums.
Yeah. The chorus is amazing.
Oh my gosh.
It's like one of those just wake you up type
of
things.
Like, not expected.
Yeah. I'll be driving and vibing and it still gets me. I love this song, man.
Yeah.
It actually made me fall in love with Florence. Like, I never really listened to Florence and the Machine much for whatever reason. And, man, this is a great song. Great collaboration. I like how the little rhyme scheme that Florence goes into where she's talking about the hurricane with her name or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like, just that whole part.
Yeah. Multiple rhymes within the line.
And it's just a clever lyric, too.
And, like, Kelsey pointed out in our reaction that it actually relates to her song Hurricane Drunk, or at least references her own song.
Super cool.
I feel like in the reaction I didn't vibe as much to it as I do now. Like, this one really grew on me. The hook is so infectious.
Yeah, this one grew on me too.
Lust. Just lust.
Talking about fantasizing about a guy that she's not with, and am I guilty? Because I mean, we haven't even touched. Like,
yeah.
It's all in my mind. We're good, right?
Well, yeah.
This must have been like a real iconic song in my childhood because I always want to reference songs to it. But Wicked Games by Chris Isaak. This, I almost think, was inspired by that a little bit. It has that guitar part. Kind of the theme of Wicked Game, I could see applying to a relationship as well.
I love that song.
It also did seem inspired by Downtown Lights. I think the drums a bit were inspired by the Blue Nile song that she referenced. But the part that's most devastating to me is like she does all this fantasizing and then she ends it with, "Am I allowed to cry?" So it's like double-edged sword there where she's fantasizing, I guess it gets done fantasizing, and then it is now like the realization comes in that,
dang it,
I'm not with this person.
He's just a poster on my wall.
Right.
I love it. It's so catchy. I can't help but sing along every time it comes on.
Yeah, I like how she literally like screams the hook as she says, "As I scream, who's afraid of little old me?" And then it gets into that deep, dark, "Well, you should be" type
atmosphere. I liked seeing this side of her a little bit.
I really love just the lyrics throughout some of this stuff when she talks about like the gallows. That's a very old world type of thing, and just to like weave that into your lyrics I think is really cool. And she talks about like covens and just some darker stuff that I didn't expect, but I really like. I think it fits the aesthetic of this album.
Agreed. There's a lot of dark imagery on this, and I even saw somebody like tally up how many times she references like death or killing on all her albums, and this one was by far the most. I take it as, which we talked about a bit in the reaction, you know, the media circus, the industry. When negativity is constantly thrown at you, eventually you gotta like kind of get calloused up. You gotta get mean back because you can't just take it all day long. Like, you have to evolve to the atmosphere you're in.
Yeah. People can ignore negativity, but when you're at the level that Taylor Swift's at, where you could walk out of your hotel and be, you know, slammed with paparazzis asking you negative stuff, it's like, yeah, eventually you have to do something to protect yourself from that.
In the production on this, there's like these bass swells. I love it. It's cinematic in a way.
I know what you're talking about.
I think it fits the gallows whole imagery of it. Like,
it's haunting.
Yeah.
Yes. Very. That's a great way to put it.
And there's a bit of a like marching band drum that comes in that helps build the tension.
Oh, yeah.
And then with that, there's like this pulsing that starts to come in that builds up into the crescendo.
I love whenever the production can like, you know, build tension like that with the lyrics.
You really think she can, but if you, the last lyric, she says, "Whoa, maybe I can."
Yeah, so. Yeah. I love that.
I like how she saves that for the end, just the last line. She's convinced herself the whole time until we were kind of talking the first time about how it had to have been like a big event or some sort of big thing that made her change her mind quickly and abruptly like that.
Seeing someone's true colors This album is just like so relatable for me because I've been in so many of these situations. I've seen so many situations like this where you think you can fix broken people, but a lot of times you can't.
Yep. They gotta fix themselves, unfortunately.
Yep.
They have to want it too.
I really like the vibe of this one. I feel like this is the most, it's not country, like it's a Western feel to it. It's a short one, but I like it.
Making it short could be calling back to the short-lived relationship.
I like that.
2 minutes, 2 weeks, a fortnight. Connecting things. Loss of my
life. In order to be a loss of your life, it had to have been a love of your life. So
exactly.
I take it as that, but I also think his perspective, since the hook is really about, he says, "I'm the love of his life." I think that's kind of connection. But I love, again, the twist at the end. I think that's something that she picked up from her country storytelling, is a lot of country music will lead you through and then at the end it flips it. And she does that often. I feel beautifully sad.
God, great way to put it.
I listened with my headphones in the dark one night when I was trying to get Riley to sleep, and it just really hit me like how emotional and just getting rid of all my other senses. I was really just in the moment listening.
So you cried?
I'll be real with you guys. I've shed tears to this album. I'm not even going to lie.
I like the, you know, talking to stuff being fake in this. When your impressionist paintings of heaven turned out to be fakes.
Something counterfeits dead. Yeah. That lyric still gets me.
Me too. She feels like she was duped, and I don't know if that's, you know, that 10-year period, maybe he was leading her on.
Also, what a bland goodbye. I know that's like a lyric you could look past a lot, but sometimes you don't get closure. Sometimes it is a bland goodbye. Now that we're sitting here talking about this, I'm seeing that theme more and more through the second half of this album is like imagination versus reality, you know, yeah. Or expectation yeah. versus reality, sort of. 'Cause I can do it with a
broken heart. Goes into like Europop now.
The sound for this one is just off the charts. I know we were all jamming to it the first right. time we heard it, and I've been doing so even more.
I like it because it represents the song, you know, the upbeatness. I've seen a lot of memes on social media where they're like, she's like crying, but then Jack's back there like bopping like a DJ. She's heartbroken, but she still has to do her day job. She still has to entertain thousands upon thousands of people.
This one really resonated with me just because I've never really thought about that, you know. I mean, we've interviewed touring musicians and it's like you see them before the show, beat down, tired, been on the road, you know, like that's tough.
It is.
Especially when you're going through like something personal too, to just go out and fake a smile and give the people what they want.
Sing breakup songs like
yeah
without.
Oh my gosh.
And it's not just her job on the line, she's responsible for all those other people that work for her and yep. are dependent on her doing that. That's a lot of pressure.
It is like this because even though she's telling her personal story, it is relatable to a lot of people. I mean, a lot of people, you're going through stuff but you still got to go to your job
for
you
sure.
still got to do all this stuff to maintain your life or else it all falls apart. So mm-hmm. and then the whole end just makes me laugh. Even though it's so dark, you know, I'm miserable, like
yeah, how she says
and
it,
nobody even knows.
Yeah, smallest man who ever. I think this might be her most scathing song. Dear John's up
oh,
there.
I don't know about that.
Does not put
yeah, she goes
any
in.
Positive light on the person. But during this bridge she's like, why did this happen? Who wanted me dead? Did you sleep with a gun under your bed? Were you writing a book? Were you in a sleeper cell spot?
She seems very paranoid.
Right. She's just trying to... I think she wants one of these reasons versus what the truth is.
Yeah.
She'd rather than be a spy or
yeah,
something.
That's a good point.
That is like, oh, that's why. I love the buildup in this, though. It gets to almost like a rock part during it. It's not like sad piano the whole time. It builds. So then, you know, if we want to take in the entire storyline, like that's where that relationship ends.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think a new one begins here with the alchemy.
For sure.
A lot of people have related this to Travis.
I do love this because of all the darkness we just talked about, and then to see the album, you know, end on a positive note.
Gave a little bit of levity to the album. I mean, it was pretty dark, sad before. This does kind of bring it up a little bit because mm-hmm. it's a nice love song. The production on it is what hooked me first. Like, it's just got a nice, full sound to it in the hook.
The name hooked me because I just think about like oxytocin or like love chemical, you know, those
right.
are like even the chemicals in your brain changing when you like fall for someone.
Totally.
That's the vibe I took.
The rainbow after the storm.
Right. Look like clairable. I think it touches on the fame aspect of it,
which has been an underlying theme.
Right. Through the whole thing. We listened to this, we were kind of confused, like, why are these in quotes?
We were trying to figure
it out. We didn't totally piece it together, but through comments and stuff.
Yeah, the comments really helped me.
Thank you guys.
And helped me understand the song more and have a better appreciation for it.
So much.
Yeah, when you're the it girl, everybody's compared to you that's coming up behind you and what that does to those people, but also you.
Yep.
And then her ending with herself, being like self-aware enough to know that, oh, I am that person now.
Love to hear artists talk about the struggles of fame. They're being vulnerable.
It's a side we don't see.
No.
And they're the only ones that really experience it. So to hear them talk about it is interesting. It humanizes them in a way.
Totally.
I know a lot of people don't want to hear it because they're like, oh, you're famous though and you got a bunch of money. You shouldn't be complaining. But everybody's human. Everybody has their own experience.
Can,
and
yeah.
they have a right to those emotions and feelings.
Absolutely.
Feelings are valid.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I recently just rewatched the Miss Americana Netflix documentary. She was very self-aware that she had a limited time on top. You could really feel the pressure that she was feeling to constantly live up to people's expectations and then make the most of the time that she had, because she knew that it was limited.
Put yourself in that mindset, that constant worry of like, I'm the it person, but it's not going to be forever.
Right.
She has broken the mold on that. And like, same, you know, same with some of the other artists she mentions here, like, you know, Stevie Nicks. I mean, she's timeless.
Totally.
There are some greats out there right now. Taylor's one of them. And I just, I love to see that genuine music and genuine artists are still out there doing it.
I like seeing more of the singer-songwriter types, the people that are making their own music and not having songs written for them.
Yeah.
And I think that's why she's been so successful, because she's writing honest and genuine songs that people can relate to.
Yeah.
And she sings them with vulnerability, and she's just mad talented.
So glad we got to talk about this. I've had this album on repeat all 2 weeks, honestly. Same. What I really took from this as I listened to it was that it really seemed like a documentation of a small part of her life. And maybe each album is kind of that anyway, because it's made during a period. But this really felt like her journal of each day. And she went in with those feelings and what she wrote and recorded it.
And love can make you do some crazy things.
That's she had blinders on.
Yeah.
So now we're going to reveal our favorite songs. Kelsey, you want to go first?
Oh, I need to go first. Okay. Yep. Number 3 is But Daddy, I Love Him. I think I had mentioned before, it reminds me of the Taylor that I fell in love with, so I think that's probably why I'm partial to that song. And then number 2 is I Can Do It With a Broken Heart, because that song is a jam. Mm-hmm. And like I had mentioned, I love her vulnerability on that one, just being more open with us. And then number 1 is Who's Afraid of Little Old Me.
Nice.
I really, really love that song. I cannot stop singing it.
That's a solid
list.
Just
got a good sound to it and really catchy. I love it.
You got any honorable mentions?
It's going to be My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys.
Nice.
Oh, man.
Solid.
Been stuck in my head since we went over it.
Guilty of Sin is my number 3.
Okay.
Then Down Bad. And then But Daddy, I Love Him, which is surprising.
Oh, that's a number 1. Okay.
And that song, I don't know.
That's surprising for you.
I think it's got everything. It's got her message. It's got a great metaphor. You know, I used to love country, but something about this, the blending of it, I just really love. And
so
I love.
Do you think the content of the song raised it up a little bit for you?
Definitely. Like if it was literally just about her dad,
then
I wouldn't. I'd be like, oh, that's a story that's done before.
But that's the fact that I took it for the last 2 weeks. But Daddy, I love him.
The bridge part, yeah. So yeah, and then honorable mention. I think it had to be Who's Afraid of Little Old Me.
Nice. I would say my 3rd favorite song is Fortnite, just because I love Post Malone. And it starts the album. I agree with what you said, that bass synth is super infectious. And I've watched the music video so many times. And shout out to Taylor for directing her music videos, because they're just so cool.
They are.
That one's so cool when she paints his tattoos on, or like rubs his tattoos on her face. I mean, it's just really, really cool. My 2nd favorite is Florida, just because it turned me on to Florence. And I love the drums before the chorus. Like we talked about, I love that switch. And I love to see the features shine like they did. My number 1 is So Long London.
Okay. Not what I would have expected. Yeah. I mean, before this, you did talk highly about it during it, so I thought maybe.
Her and the piano, and the chords that are used.
Yeah.
How she sings in a lower octave. I mean, it just like...
Beautiful.
Those are the songs that give me chills. And I would say for honorable mentions, I definitely have 1 or 2. I'm going to say But Daddy, I Love Him is on there now, just because you blew my mind. Totally changed the whole perspective there. And then My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys, just because it's
the bop.
I just love the drums, man. Jack
drums
is just
so good.
A clown. You all should let us know what your favorite songs are off this album in the comments. It's been 2 weeks. Hit us up in the comments. We love talking to you guys down there. We're also going to be dropping TTPD Anthology 2 weeks later.
In a week.
So make sure you subscribe for that. And we will catch you all in the next video.
Peace.
Later.